So there'll be some folks joining us as we go along, I expect, but I'm going to get started. Back when I was a teenager, I started practicing art, and it really was kind of a practice. It was not trying to be perfect or even good, just coming up with images that I thought were interesting and moved me somehow. And at that same time, my dad, who was, I think all most of you know, was a preacher and a teacher. And the Old Testament prophets were really important to him. He had a real sense of social justice that harkened back to those prophets. And so the first painting I want to show you that Jenny's is called Young Rebel, Old Prophets. And it's really kind of a depiction of me and my father, two ages. This painting about the 60s and how I was certainly one of those young rebels. And of course, we're involved in the anti-war movement. And I remember going to a meeting. I was at protests against Nixon's first inauguration in 1969. And me and a high school pal of mine went to an SDS meal, free spaghetti. And everybody was arguing about extreme tactics and what to do about violence and how to stop the war. And because my dad was involved in supporting civil rights and my mom as well, and I had learned about, organizers from the civil rights movement, it was a real turning point for me. I realized that the more fundamental work of the civil rights movement was very different from the new left radicals, all those folks in SDS who I was in that meeting with. And so for me, that was a real turning point to be involved in organizing and realize how important organizing was. And so this painting is really looking back on sort of my dad and my mom's teaching and learning about long traditions of social justice and the importance of passing on to younger generations, lessons learned over long, long periods of time. And so
Can you point it down just a little bit more?
Sure.
You see below. Ah, thank you. There you go.
Oh, there's the fourth face. So who are the four faces?
Well, moi, of course, a depiction of my dad as an old man, my dad as a young man, and me now, sort of.
Okay. We're
You look
moving
like you're
past.
dreaming.
Oh.
Okay.
So Jenny and I started working together in 1980. And I realized that when she talked to me about doing anti-apartheid work at Miami University, that this was the woman for me. I mean, there were other things about her that were very attractive, but certainly that made a lot of difference. And she and I taught adult basic education at Jewish Vocational Services, downtown Cincinnati. And all of our students were reading about a third grade level. Almost all Black women, all poor, most likely find out how much money they made, which is probably nothing. And Jenny was particularly good at helping those students think about how they could build a sense of voice. Even when they would write maybe two or three lines, But we would ask them to write every week. And so this next painting is called Learners Become Educators. These students, we were asked to do a Black history presentation to a Catholic girls high school, Mother of Mercy High School. And rather than Jenny or I doing that presentation, we asked our students in the ABE class to do the presentation. And for them, it really was a real transformation for them becoming leaders, for them to find a sense of voice. They really felt like they changed the lives of those high school students. Mm. And they got $50 to do this presentation.
Ooh.
They started a book club. First book they chose was Waiting to Exhale. And for us, it was, a tremendous learning that once people were able to find their voice, they began to become leaders. Mm. And that we, as a rule of thumb, believe that anybody could lead. That we really needed give people a chance to find their voice. And we would do an activity with people, and over again in many different settings, we would ask people how they got silenced. What happened to us? What happened to people that they were silenced, that their voice was taken away? And so people would express feelings of guilt and shame and fear. And they would start to release those feelings, and this would be a process where they could begin to find a sense of voice and realize what they needed to change about being able to speak for themselves. And so for these ABE students, this was a huge turning point for them. We, of course, Jane and I were laid off about 2 weeks after mm-hmm. the club started, because our students, unfortunately, were becoming unruly and not willing to go along with the usual program at the adult basic education class. So this is a depiction of a time in Cincinnati. Most of you, I think, will remember when Timothy Thomas was killed. There was probably a dozen incidents where primarily young Black men were shot and killed by the police, the Cincinnati police. And me, along with a lot of other people, organized a March for Justice, which was in May of 2001. And it was a culmination of a lot of demonstrations and what was called at that time, rebellion. There were a lot of spontaneous demonstrations in Cincinnati. But this March for Justice was about 2,000 people from Fountain Square past District 1 police station to Ezra Charles Park in the West End. So for Jenny and I, this whole time period was a really fruitful one. And at that time I was working as a popular educator and we workshop style an introduction to popular education, which we did a number of times. And for me, and I think for Jenny too, but she can speak to this, art is a kind of practice, and organizing is a kind of practice, and leadership development is a kind of practice, all imperfect and all emergent and all working to connect further with people. And so that really was a time period for me when a lot of those lessons were really brought home.
Were those real names of buildings, or were those, I couldn't read the building names.
Really, those are political issues.
I thought it was sort of like, I saw one that said Equity.
Equity, yeah. Bank, maybe.
I mean, I can.
Yeah, Cincinnati's not that progressive. Buildings named Equity.
Read it too clear.
You know, the first national bank of money laundering, Prison Industries, Inc., on and on and on.
Thank you.
So for me, the March for Justice and the work around popular education was about building collectivity. And us folks who are middle class, collectivity is a real challenge because we get taught so early on that being middle class is about how smart we are, you know, or how accomplished we are, or, you know, what our network looks like or something. And Jenny has just been the most important person in my life about showing how collectivity and accountability based on being together in large groups is where change is generated from. And in this day and age, you know, when the middle class is under so much assault in so many different ways. Now, the working class in the United States as well, but the middle class very much so. It is always tough for us in the middle class to figure out how to be accountable and to how to work collectively. Recently, Jenny and I have been going to a lot of SAG-AFTRA events to support the strike. Once upon a time, Jenny was in SAG-AFTRA.
Well, that's a whole another story.
Yeah, that's another story. But it's.
Let me ask a stupid question.
Go ahead. Yeah.
Harry, what's the difference in the definition of middle class and working class?
Well, that's a really, it's a very good question. You know, in many ways, it's our relationship to, you know, the powers that be in society. Because if we align ourselves with the powers that be, you know, we tend to aspire to much more the middle class or the upper middle class. If we aspire to be part of, you know, the great working class of people, that's a very different orientation. But there are many, many people who are just torn all the time between the two, you know, dynamics.
Yeah, I'm thinking about people that are in unions who I would definitely define as working class, but if they've got a decent union, they're making pretty good wages.
Sure.
What's left of the unions?
Yeah, and for me, it's also about, you know, if you are exploited by your employer, if the employer is taking, you know, your work and profiting from it, that's a very different relationship than if you're an independent store owner or something like that. So for me and Jenny, you know, has would you tell a story about the blood drive?
Well, when I was in eighth grade, my sister's boyfriend died of leukemia. And they were a family that lived in our neighborhood, which was a working class neighborhood with lots of ethnic diversity. And so when I heard that this, well, so my I was friends with the guy who died. I was friends with his sister. She was in my classroom and we were friends. And they didn't have much money, and they needed to pay back all the blood that he was given in the hospital. Mm-hmm. So I talked to my favorite teacher, who was all about helping, and so we planned to have a blood drive at our school. And my friend, you know, I had said something to her about that I wanted to do this, and she was embarrassed. She didn't want me to do it, but I went ahead and did it. And so we got the whole school to give blood. And my friend Joetta, who was this Latino woman, part Latino and part Appalachian, she was actually my best friend. And she was too underweight blood. She weighed like 95 pounds and you had to weigh 100 pounds. So she put pennies in her shoes. And so when they weighed her, you know,
she cowboy boots.
Enough. Yeah. But it was a really, and my friend Denise, who was, you know, who had lost her brother, her only sibling, when she, Denise was like 14 and her brother was like 16 when he died. And, but anyway, she got over being upset with me because it was a really good community building experience, and they were grateful that they didn't have the money to pay it back. So it all worked out really well.
Thanks.
Sure.
So for me, it's a good example of people sticking together. And I think during this time, you know, when democracy is under assault, when, you know, the drive towards war, the U.S. foreign policy is really, you know, pushing war, that people really do need to stick together in a massive way. And that's very, very challenging right now. And so the last painting I wanted to show you was it's a painting called She Persisted. So, I mean, that's Jenny's profile, her silhouette, but it reminds me of all the women who are leaders in this time and certainly in many other times. But there's an organization that's registering new voters called Field Team 6 across the country, and they have 17,000 volunteers. And 85% of those volunteers are women. And to me, it's an indication of how much women are taking the lead, women of color, women from all over the country, in terms of this time of organizing. Because I think there are many, many people, and certainly a lot of men, who are very confused and sort of their worldviews are being broken apart in their own minds. They really are very uncertain about what, you know, how the world works and what all this means and what all this change is that's happening. And so people are blaming a lot of folks for all kinds of problems. And so, you know, for us, this whole process of organizing is also about people able to reconstruct new worldviews that are about people coming together, about building communities, about building a way to live, and of change. So there are lots of other paintings that were in this show, but I didn't want to spend too much time on all this. That's all I wanted to talk about. If people have questions or comments.
I think Jenny, did you say?
Or it's just like when your show, did you have descriptions that you're telling us next to the pictures so that people understood some of the context for you?
That's a great question. there was an artist statement. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'll read just a very short portion of it. There are a million ways to be in solidarity, stand together, or be one for all for one. Organizing provides a path for people to stand together and gain a better life and a fuller sense of our own humanity. Learners become educators shows a group of ABE students presenting the importance of Black history to a group of high school students. The fee they received from this talk they devoted to starting a book. The first book they chose was Waiting to Exhale. These students' averaging level was the third grade. So you're right, Jenny, that I could have provided more explanation or more context.
Well, I'm sure people took meaning from it as was, but it's also interesting to hear, particularly sort of the historical context from which you're coming, which people who were coming in might not have had.
Yeah. I mean, it was and is a very personal show. It's probably the most personal show I've ever done. But I'm really, in the last couple of years, really tending towards that. The show previous to this on art and quantum biology, if you have questions about that, I'd be happy to talk about it more at some point. So.
Sure.
Jenny, I can talk about my experience a little bit, seeing Steve's show at the beginning of the month, and we were there for the reception where Steve and Jenny were there. And it's a First Friday thing that they do in town where other galleries are open with other shows. So we started there where Steve's show was, and we did get some of that personal explanation and the background behind the images that really helped me a lot. And to me, expressed the personal creation that was being displayed on the walls. And I left there after we had, chatted for a while. We went to some of the other galleries, and I was left empty at the other art, because to me, it just wasn't providing the same kind of visceral personal statement that Steve was making. And everything was about technique and pretty images. And I walked to those other galleries and said, I don't see anything here I really am that interested in looking at. You spoiled that night for me, Steve.
I appreciate that comment, but you also have a particular perspective on all of these things too.
How's that?
Well, as being
of the family,
you've known me even longer than Jenny Ladd, and Jenny Ladd's known me a long time. But that, I mean, I appreciate that, because it's very much what I'm going for. And really, when I wanted to do more art more seriously, is to try and have some vision and some sense of what message I really want to get across with the images, rather than I'm really like the idea of the Buddhist concepts of impermanence and imperfection, that I'm never going to get close to perfection in art, but I do want to communicate some visual ideas.
But you're also, the story that you're communicating is also one, and your brother is giving another facet of it about the context in which you're presenting your art. It's a the class context you were talking about earlier, a lot of that is, a commodity context where you're trying to, middle class people are trying to sell, canvas or something, and therefore, that much affects the art and its content. And yours is, in Peru, they call it the art of commitment, arte comprometido. You know, your commitment is what is coming through here, and it's authentic. And it's, the technique is a little bit beside the point, frankly, because of the story is what is important. And I think that is part of what's going on here, too. And I think we should reverence that, frankly. Thank Mac, you.
Would you say a little bit about your connection to Latin American art where you're coming from about that, because I really appreciate that comment.
Yes, I will. If you'll give me 1 second, I'm going to bring a friend to the camera to help me with this conversation. Won't take a second.
I wish I had a picture in front of me to show you this, but in the seventh grade, my son Jonathan, they must have studied the Great Depression in social studies. And he drew this picture. The markings were a lot like yours. It said the Great Depression. And then there was boxes with like six different pictures, like, where's my money? And the bank's going, blowing up and going bankrupt, and the soup lines. It just reminds me so much of what you're trying to do there. And I'm going to have to look for that.
Yeah.
Can everybody see this?
I gotcha. Yep.
What do you think the name of this sculpture is? Look at the stone.
Yeah, my guts.
Well, hunger.
The Mars. Name of the sculpture is Hunger. Oh. Okay. It's Peru, right? The guy that did the cover of Gutierrez on Western Theology, his first book, Adalberto Merida, is the sculptor, okay? And it's the art of commitment. It speaks to us in part because of the message, the commitment of the people, and the unpacking the story becomes very crucial. So I, like your brother and the other people on this call, Steve, suggest that your story and your and Jenny's story is a crucial part of this, helping us interpret what we need to be thinking about in terms of our lives, including your class reflection about how we're torn as middle class people working class people, and but are sometimes tempted to aspire for to participate in the economy more fully, shall we say. And so that's liberating. That's that interpretation is really important. And what's not so important is technique, frankly.
Well, I mean, I appreciate what you're saying. There are lots and lots of ways for art, to be, moving people. And really, for me, this is the way that's most meaningful. It's not the only way to do it. But this show, was really precipitated, by what's going on in the U.S. right now, and frankly, other parts of the world, because so many people, I think, are so so perplexed about what could happen, what is happening, what should about it, and it's very easy for all of us to just sort of submerge ourselves in distractions, or submerge ourselves in making money, or just our families, whatever it might be.